Another interview for you with the artist, and we will find out shortly. What is your name?
Natalia Rudichev.
Natalia Rudichev, and can you talk a little bit about what do you do, where are you, what's your expertise in the field?
Well, I'm a multidisciplinary artist and I'm a scholar. When I came to the United States, I already had 3 master's degrees, one in Romano-Germanic philology, one in education in English and French languages, and one candidate of sciences degree in social philosophy. So I came to United States as a junior faculty Fulbright scholar, and then I continued my education with Duquesne University, receiving master's degree in philosophy of art and PhD ABD in philosophy of art as well. But I've always practiced art since I was little, so I was writing poetry since the age of 13, free verse and Japanese style poetry such as haiku and tanka. And when I moved...
What's the distinction in Japanese poetry from all the other ones?
Well, it's a very, like, this type of poetry specifically, because Japanese obviously write longer poems too. These are very short. These are 3 lines. In Japan, they would be 575 in haiku and 57577 in tanka. But right now there's a big movement in the United States and all around the world to practice haiku and tanka. And we found out that the capacities of English language and Japanese language are different. What is very natural and almost nursery rhyme-like for Japanese language is not such a natural structure for the English language. So it was decided by, for example, American Haiku Society, that we would preserve the spirit of the poem but wouldn't stick to what you're usually taught in school. 575 is just a short poem with a seasonal reference.
Well, hold a second, let me cut you for a sec. Let me ask you with the question that we discussed on the preparation for the interview. We spoke about the maybe a funny story, maybe a sad story about writing poetry. Is there like a story that you can share about poetry writing that might be bringing sympathy and empathy from the audience to you?
Oh yes, of course, because in my experience, every time I wrote a haiku and won an award, it was from a real life experience. Like, for example, I won Robert Spears Award for haiku, Sakura Award in Canada, Kasumakura Taishō in Japan, and also San Francisco International Haiku Competition. And what's interesting about the haiku submitted to that... There's a story behind that haiku. So the haiku goes, a heart drawn in snow, still falling. And the story behind that haiku, I was living in Chicago area at that time, and I was often looking outside because there would be a lot of geese moving around. And I enjoyed watching them, and since my grandma comes from St. Petersburg and no scrap of food is ever discarded because people were starving there to death. So on occasion I was giving scraps of food to these geese. And I was watching one young goose for quite a while, and it was already winter season. And it looked strange and different from other birds. It was all kind of wet and trying constantly to clean itself and preen its feathers. And I kept on looking at it, and I returned a couple of hours later and it was still doing it. So eventually I went out and looked at the goose, and the goose was covered in oil. So there was no way in winter it would clean itself and stay alive. Basically, it was slowly freezing to death. So I'm like very empathetic person. I panicked. I started calling all kinds of places. Finally, I found a bird rescue place. They arrived by nightfall with a heavy snowfall. So I helped them to corral that poor geese that was still trying to fly into the corner. And like after we've done that and the goose was finally with bird rescue people, I found in the snow some child draw a hat. And that's why like the haiku was inspired by that connection with the bird and the heart drawn in the snow. A couple of months later, I checked with the bird rescue place. The bird survived, was properly cleaned, then nutritioned and cared and released in spring into the wild.
Wonderful story. Thank you so much for rescue. That's truly means a lot for this particular geese, right? The other question that I ask you to prepare, maybe a life hack, some kind of advice for people who write poetry or who read poetry, like for the folks who are in that space, do you have a kind of a suggestion how to make their poetry better or how to find best poetry? Yes, the wind is.
But yeah, the wind is dangerous. Mm. Almost.
Okay.
This is the book that I've published, and it's called Simple Gifts. And I've also done the Sumiye painting for the cover, and the photographs that divide the seasonal parts of this book. And this book was shortlisted for Touchstone Distinguished Book Award in 2018. And in this book, there's a poem that says, nameless, a stepped on flower slowly reshapes itself. So I think we all can take time and give ourselves just permission to, if anything drastic happens in our life, just step back, reflect on that as an experience that not crushed us but helped us to reshape ourselves and become better and more beautiful. And at the same time, like, we can think like, oh, perfect thing, perfectly symmetrical things are beautiful, but in Japanese culture and aesthetics, worn things, torn things, repaired things are valued. And maybe it's very good to return to that kind of stance in life, to what our grandparents used to do, not to be consumerists, but to be creators. Like, for example, I had some left thread and I just created a scarf. I had a little silver wire and I created little jewelry. I'm not a jewelry maker or a fabric artist, but on occasion I do that as well. I do photography and I've won several international awards for my photographic projects, like International Tokyo Photo Award in 2020 for my personality editorial section. I won a bronze award and an honorable mention for International Photography Awards, and have several projects like on Social Documentary Network and in several other places. Like, today is the last day to go to Soho Photo Gallery and see my piece there that was presented in National Competition Winners exhibition. And from May 1st to May 20th, you may see my work in Portland, Oregon. It's called Wabi Sabi and comes from my Recycle, Reuse, Repurpose, Reinvent in Art and Life project. And soon, in Praxis Photo Art Center in Minneapolis, Minnesota, there'll be my black and white image in monochrome exhibition. And in Los Angeles in June, they're gonna open a mental health awareness exhibition, and they will also have my image on the wall.
Is there like a social media? Do you have like a Instagram by any chance?
Yes, Natalia Rudichev, That's my Instagram page. I also have Natalia Rudichev Haiku. So Natalia Rudichev would be for my photography work. Natalia Rudichev Haiku would be for my poetry. There's also a thing called Happy Stretched and Strong, because I've developed a particular movement technique that I teach over COVID for a year already for a group of over 60 individuals, because it's suitable for anybody to find their strengths and core. These are actually very advanced individuals that do yoga their whole life, but I help them find length in their spinal cord and strengthen their core, because I've also studied for 3 years at the School of Modern Dance, Martha Graham School of Modern Dance, and received in my advanced age, I'm gonna be 50 this winter, in 2017, a scholarship to go to Rome to study modern dance there. And I went on an intensive just before COVID to Greece to study Isidora Duncan technique.
Wow, thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, maybe you can check out those links if you remember those. And cut.